Hello, I'm Sabine O'Hara, Dean of the University of the District of Columbia's College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences, and your host. Our mission is to offer you research-based community education as well as our traditional academic programs. And joining me on this edition of Causes are two people who are an important part of our community education programs, Mary Farrah and Yao Afantchao from the Causes Center for Urban Agriculture and Gardening Education. Yao and Mary are here to discuss two topics, ethnic and specialty crops, which are growing in popularity in North America. These crops make up 12% or more of all retail food sales, and shrubs, and what you can do right now in your backyard to get ready for the next growing season. Welcome back to Causes, Mary and Yao.
Thank you.
Yao, let me start with you. Ethnic and specialty crops. A lot of people may not exactly know what that means. And there is, of course, a difference between those two types of crop classifications. So what does it mean? What are ethnic crops? What are specialty crops?
Well, I think all crops are ethnic in a way,
yes.
Depending on who's eating what. And some people might even say that what language do they speak? But anyway, the ethnic crops are foods that people grew up on and are used to eating all their lives, most of their lives. Mm-hmm. And so it becomes home food. So we are talking about food that your mother fed you,
yes.
And food that you ate in your community, mm-hmm. and that you seek when you go anywhere in the world.
Mm-hmm.
And if you have to spend a lot of time someplace, the one worry on your mind is, how can I find this home food? Mm-hmm. And so this is, in a nutshell, what ethnic and specialty foods can mean, because of specialty, especially because of cooking, and you know, it has a special place in your cooking.
Yes.
So the French may use a lot of garlic in cooking, butter in cooking, the Germans, cabbage.
Mm-hmm.
You have to have it.
You have to have it.
So, and the Africans, they may, depending on where you are, maybe the garden eggs and the okra and jute leaf.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what it means.
So in other words, we're talking about crops that are not your commercial crops, not, you know, wheat, barley, those kinds of crops that are grown large scale here in the United States,
yeah.
But more the kind of crop varieties that you would grow in your yard.
Yes, yeah, mm-hmm. Vegetables.
Vegetables.
Not your mono called crops.
Yeah, not the large scale soybean production.
Not the grains,
yes.
And not the, you know,
yes.
Not the beans and.
Yeah.
But things that people eat, have access to, mm-hmm. on daily basis, and cook.
And love to eat. You know, one of the foods, when you said the foods that you grow up with and you're familiar with and you crave when you can't find them, for me, that is kohlrabi. Because I grew up in Germany, right? And kohlrabi, everybody has it in their yard. You just grow it. And you can slice it raw with a little bit of salt on it. You can shred it and make a salad. You can sauté it. And it's so difficult to find, although within the last few years, you know, I've been here in the United States for a long time now, almost 30 years, but within the last few years, I'm finding more of those crops that I grew up with and that for, you know, 28 years I couldn't find them, and now all of a sudden here they are.
Yeah.
Is that sort of a trend? Do we get more crop varieties?
Well, yes. As people move around, and move to other spots in the world,
mm-hmm.
I think they manage to sneak in their food. And so as your rabbi is here, our garden eggs are here,
yes.
And the hot peppers are here.
Yes.
Fortunately for the Africans, though, the Caribbeans are not too far off. So the Caribbeans bring things in, and Latin America, things get in. And of course, in every suitcase coming to the U.S. nowadays, you know, something is in there.
Don't tell the USDA.
Yes. You know,
you're not supposed to right. do that, right?
But you're not supposed to. But we at Causes have identified this need. And we went after it.
Yes.
And we, our goal is to make these ethnic or home foods
yes.
available, accessible, and affordable
yeah.
to the eaters.
Yeah.
Yes.
And of course, here in the district, we have people from literally all over the world. I understand we have more embassies in this town than at any other capital in the world, right? So we wow. have a big, big variety of people, big diversity of people, and who are looking for foods, as you said, from where they come from, right? And
That's
want
right.
to buy them fresh and so forth. And so out at our research farm, at Merkirk Farm in Beltsville, we do a lot of research and start different varieties of crops that fall into this ethnic and specialty crop family.
Well,
and of course, you're our expert, Mr. Yao.
Well, after the identification of this need, the first step that we had to tackle was to consult actually with stakeholders,
yes.
both in the school and also in the community, to see what is it really they want that we can study. And so we started with crop study, crop research, to find out adaptability to the climate, soil, name it, in everything that goes into studying a plant. We started that way. And then we had people come to look and say, does it look like something you might want?
Yes.
And they say, oh yes, you can't grow enough of it. But Mary here, I'm so happy to be to have Mary on a set with me today, because I'm comfortable. We have worked together so many times, so many days in the communities, and she can tell you, she's my witness as to how people react when they see some of these crops
yes.
that are growing in our small demonstration gardens.
Yes.
They go crazy.
Yes. They make special requests. They say, I want you to bring this and this and this. We like hibiscus, we like the hot peppers, and bring us some jute leaf.
Yes.
But this is funny because, yeah, when we go to different gardens in the city, can tell what countries the people are from based on what they're growing.
Yes. Isn't that interesting?
I found
so
that
we
impressive.
Have how many community gardens now, roughly, in the district? 50-ish?
Well, over 50, definitely
over 50. 50.
Yes.
There's new ones coming and some old ones that have shut down, unfortunately.
And you're in many of them.
Well, we started with many. And we dwindled down because we have the farm.
Yes.
And people can actually come to the farm. We still have community gardens that you know, people can go and take a look and harvest.
And
we
our
open
demo
our
gardens.
Garden
yes.
so the people can harvest. And we have watched immigrants harvesting.
Yes.
You know, the people will see certain particular plant and they will harvest it and leave.
Yes.
And Africans, we identified some Africans, and I could tell Mary that lady is from Senegal, because she will go straight to the bisap, which is the hibiscus.
Yes.
She will go straight to it and start harvesting
picking it.
The Ghanaian lady will go to the garden egg and then start picking the garden eggs.
And who
so
has the huckleberry?
The huckleberry, Cameroon.
Yes.
The Cameroon ladies will go to the Jama Jama. Yes.
Yeah, it's so interesting. And of course, in many of these community gardens, we have small plots where we show the kind of varieties that people can grow. But of course, that's not always quite so easy, because they come from different countries. They come from the African continent or from Europe or from Asia, where the growing conditions and the climate is very different than here in the District of Columbia. And then you have to first experiment with it and see what works, what doesn't, how can you grow it. And so those are some of the plots we have in the community gardens. And of course, now at a much larger scale also at the farm where we see what works. And some of the growing methods may also be different than what people are used to doing in their own backyard. So what are some of those differences? If you wanted to grow garden eggs, if you wanted to grow hibiscus, what's a good way of doing it?
Well, due to the fact that they are tropical mm-hmm. in nature, you have to start them in a greenhouse ahead of time, as I'm doing now. I'm seeding so that they can sprout, and I will pot them, and by April, the end of April, I set them outside to invigorate them so that they can get used to the weather. And by mid-May, mm-hmm. they should go in the ground. Mm-hmm. And by the end of July, 1st August, you should be harvesting. And mm-hmm. so I am happy to report that these crops grow exceedingly well. They're doing very well. I have not had any problems.
They're very drought tolerant.
Oh, good. Yeah, because they come from Africa, of course. So when we have water shortages in the summer, they can make it.
They thrive. Right.
They thrive.
Yeah.
Yes.
Where my tomatoes don't necessarily thrive.
They don't do so well.
and so if you plant well, also you can have multiple pickings. Mm. You can pick up until second week of October or first frost.
Yeah. Yes. Now you said you started in the greenhouse, and of course we have quite a few greenhouses now at the farm as we've been expanding our ethnic and specialty crops areas. But I tell you, I started mine, and they're still inside, on top of my refrigerator. Hmm. So you can actually do it in your kitchen and probably, you know.
Yeah. I do thousands of seedlings.
Yeah.
So I have passed the top of the refrigerator.
You have passed.
But for the individual,
my own backyard, it works.
I have some in my house too.
You do.
We have a setup where we have just a couple flats mm-hmm. For the early spring vegetables, the brassicas and some onions. And there's a device built where we just have different heights for the grow lights, so mm-hmm. we can just raise them up as the seedlings get taller.
Mary, you're much more sophisticated than I am. I just have my one tray, and that's where I have
My boyfriend built it. I didn't do all of it yet.
Okay. So you have some expertise.
I had some help, yes.
You had some help with that. But, you know, the point is, I mean, people don't need a lot of space
to do it,
right? If you are not as ambitious as Yao of starting thousands of them, but if you just want them for your own backyard, you can actually do it in your house. And
absolutely.
Right?
Yeah. Absolutely.
And still preserve some of your living space. Because sometimes my gardening experience have a tendency to sort of
take over,
creep over in from the kitchen into other rooms of the house. So then I have to sort of rein them back in and say, now, how many people are in my household now that my sons have grown up? You know, who's going to eat all this, right?
But that's part of our education in the community, that we can show people how to do these things on small scale, and also grow these things in small spaces and grow abundantly.
Yeah.
So it's nothing wrong with working from your kitchen counter.
From the kitchen, yes.
Just so long as there's light and heat.
That's
for
right.
them. Yeah.
And you need to, of course, remember to water them.
Yes.
Especially in the early stage,
before
they germinate, has to be nice and moist. So that can happen smoothly. Mm. So when it comes to the larger plants, you know, some of the okra plants we had last year out at the farm, they didn't quite look like food plants anymore, or not even tomatoes. I mean, they were growing like crazy. And we had okra that looked like shrubbery all over the place.
Weren't they beautiful?
So they were beautiful.
Yes. And we are ethnic, and of course we are international as well.
Yes.
And so some of the giant okras that you saw were from Cameroon, mm-hmm. Togo, and some from Central America, Belize.
Oh.
The white okra was from Belize, and two types of okra were from Cameroon, the red, mm-hmm. Large okra.
Yes.
And so we termed them frying okra. Uh-huh. They look very big and supposed to be too hard, but they are tender. So you can use them.
They're delicious, actually.
Yeah, someone has been in the garden.
I tasted some. Somebody experimented, yes. And of course, Togo is your home country, right?
Yes.
Very, very exciting for me to see all the different varieties out there. Because and I have my garden, though, divided into sort of two parts. I have a small yard, but when you come up from the sidewalk, I first have my flower garden, and then closer to the house, I have my vegetable garden, because that stays warm longer and gets warm earlier because it's right close to the house. But I also like to have my flowers, of course, and some of my shrubs, the larger plants. And of course, there's been a lot of talk about different shrubs here in the district. As people are putting in their gardens in the spring, those of us who are not only vegetable growers, but who are also looking at decorative plants, I have a massively big problem in my yard with invasives, those vines that grow over top of everything.
I've seen those in your yard, yes.
And right now, that's unfortunately the only thing that is already turning green, okay? Everything else is still brown, but those things seem to be really hardy.
They are really difficult to get rid of. That's one of the reasons they do so well here. And interestingly, you'll find that most of the invasive plants in this region are actually from Japan and China, because we have similar climates. They're both temperate climates. And you'll find a lot of the invasive plants, they'll spread vegetatively by like laying down roots where the vines grow, or through rhizomes or different kind of root growth. But they'll also spread by seed, and birds, a lot of them being also invasive birds like the European starling, will spread these seeds around and disperse them through the natural areas, other people's gardens. Some of the seeds will float in the streams, and then they'll spread exponentially that way. So these guys, they're tenacious, they get around, and they don't have any of the natural controls in their home ecosystem to keep their populations in control. So a lot like soil microbes can inhibit plant growth in its home population, but those soil microbes that used to do that are missing. The predators often are missing.
Yeah.
The diseases and pathogens are often missing.
So just like, you know, the ethnic crops come from areas that are not native to the district, those invasives that are much larger in scale, they've also come in from places that are not native here.
Exactly. And we have this love of exotic plants. The difference between the ethnic crops, of course, is that they have predators. They have the people from those countries here who are eating them. So that keeps the population, their populations in control.
They can't produce enough of themselves.
that's one of the main differences. Yeah. So. But yeah, so we love exotic plants, and since like the Victorian era, people have been traveling all over the world and importing these different plants into the England, Europe, and the United States.
Yeah.
And a lot of them had medicinal purposes and culinary value, but also they're very beautiful. A lot of these plants have year-round interest. They'll have flowers early in the spring, and they'll have bright leaves in the fall, and they'll have berries through the winter. So they're interesting in the garden. The push now is to stick with more native plants, because we have a lot of native plants that are also equally beautiful that serve ecological value here with the insect life they support, which then in turn support the bird life, which, so it keeps the whole ecosystem operating.
So back to more of an awareness of what our own local ecosystem is like, and how we can bring some of these plants back to rebalance things a little bit more.
I think the main thing is to make requests at the local nurseries, request that they have more native options, not hybrids, but like true natives, and then know which plants to avoid. A lot of the exotic plants aren't actually invasive. They haven't been escaping cultivation. Some of them have, and a lot of the ones that are widely established as invasive plants, like porcelainberry, English ivy, which you've seen in your yard, euonymus, or the winter creeper euonymus, the ground cover, mm-hmm. cover vine euonymus, mm-hmm. And the burning bush, winged euonymus, the bush that turns bright red in the fall. Those are some pretty well-known invasive plants, but there's new plants that are on what is called an early detection rapid response watch list. Uh-huh. These plants we're just finding now that they're escaping cultivation and naturalizing in the parks around the district and in other areas, or we'll find that they're invasive in different parts of the country, so we'll keep an eye on them, and then find, yes, they are escaping cultivation. So these are the ones to avoid buying, uh-huh. because they haven't yet established as invasive, so we're trying to curb their spread at this point.
So Mary, what are if you make a list of what are the top five natives that you would recommend people plant more of? What are they?
Well, oak leaf hydrangea is a great shrub that's considered native to this area. If you love euonymus, we have a native euonymus, the American euonymus, called, the common name is Hearts of Busting, uh-huh. and it's got a very beautiful berry that busts open in the fall, and it's pink and red. It's a very attractive plant. Mm-hmm. I love native columbine. This is more of a herbaceous perennial. Mm-hmm. It's a early spring, mid-spring bloomer, mm-hmm. And it will also bloom again in the fall, mm-hmm. Sometimes, mm-hmm. if you're lucky. Mm-hmm. Top five, let me see.
Three, well, maybe leave it at three. And which ones should we avoid?
Well, I have some pictures of those, actually. Uh-huh. So one to avoid is the leatherleaf mahonia. Mm-hmm. Now, this is one of the plants, it almost looks like holly, mm-hmm. But it has these very, right now it's blooming, it has these very, like these strings of yellow blooms that come out of the top of it, mm-hmm. And then in the fall it's got these, or the summer it develops berries that turn green and then turn blue by fall, mm-hmm. and they'll stay on through the winter. Another one to avoid is that everyone loves, is called the butterfly bush. Mm-hmm. This is actually a noxious weed in Oregon and Washington State. And I've seen this escaping cultivation. Actually, there's a apartment building right on the tip of DC, right where East-West Highway is, and there's a planting of butterfly bush there. And if you cross East-West Highway and just kind of come down this culvert into what's called Fenwick Branch, a part of Rock Creek Park, you'll find butterfly bushes in the entire riparian area.
Everywhere.
They were just taken over completely. Mm-hmm. They spread by seed, they also spread vegetatively. Mm-hmm. And people might say, why does it matter? But the fact of the matter is, I mean, they look pretty, so people like them, but they displace the native plants that are important food sources or habitat or even breeding grounds for our native ecosystem. Mm-hmm. So, mm-hmm.
So and you said, of course, we have pictures of these and we will show them as
yes.
well. And once they are, you said, escape cultivation. In other words, once they've left your backyard, they've been the seeds have been transported all over, then, of course, there are no native enemies, no predators for these plants, and that's that, right? And then it's very, very difficult.
It's difficult to control them.
To control them.
It costs, the concept of early detection rapid response is you catch a plant before it has a chance to establish itself, and you eradicate the populations, thereby saving yourself, or saving the country, millions and millions and millions of dollars in just management, not eradication, just mm-hmm. managing these plants mm-hmm. long term. Mm-hmm.
So where do people find that kind of information? Of course, we have a website, Causes website, where we have some of the information, both about the ethnic and specialty crops, but also about the invasive species.
There's a ton of resources out there. And DC Cooperative Weed Management Area has resources. We have resources at UDC as well. But National Park Service has a great set of fact sheets out. The Center for Urban Ecology's Exotic Plant Management teams developed some of the incoming invasive plant fact sheets mm-hmm. that are available on the website for the Center for Urban Ecology.
And of course, you also teach some of this in the community.
Oh, yes. We have classes. We have a class coming up in April with Casey Trees. We do mm-hmm. twice a year. It's me, a wildlife biologist from District Department of the Environment, Damien Ossie, and a biologist from Rock Creek National Park, Anna Chukin. Mm-hmm. And we do a two-part class where we teach the concept of invasive plants, common invasive plants in DC, early detection, rapid response, species management techniques. And then we follow it up with a field day where we go out into the field and actually, you know, get our volunteers dirty. So.
And Mr. Yao, you have information too about ethnic and specialty crops.
Reach everybody in person, so we do develop these booklets.
Yes.
And so we pass them around,
yes,
around town.
Mm-hmm.
Everywhere I go,
uh-huh,
I carry these with me. Mm-hmm. And so we have information for people, and we have the plant definitions,
mm-hmm,
and we have the pictures and the definitions of these plants that it can be shown.
And more classes and information materials as well out at the farm where
that's
people
right
can find
well,
additional
for the first time, we're going to be training people. We call them the urban food producers.
Yes.
And that is a title I gave my program at SARE.
Mm-hmm.
SARE, meaning Sustainable Agriculture Research and Education, is a component of the of NIFA out of USDA,
mm-hmm,
and where we reach small farmers,
mm-hmm,
actually big all types of farmers.
Yes, some not so small, right?
Not so small, yes, but agricultural related,
yes,
where the innovation comes to light.
Yes.
And if I find something interesting, I tell SARE about it, and SARE encourages that I tell other farmers about it. And so SARE will fund certain programs. And so for the first time, I will be doing a SARE training program at the farm.
Very good.
In ethnic crops.
Great. Thank you very much. My guests have been Mary Farrah and Yao Afantchao from the Center for Urban Agriculture and Gardening Education here at UDC. Thank you for joining me on Causes, a television series from the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences of the University of the District of Columbia. As your public land grant university, we are committed to conducting research and offering education programs that improve the quality of life and economic opportunity for people and communities here in the District of Columbia. This means that our academic programs must be relevant and practical, and our research-based community education programs must make a difference in the lives of DC residents and the organizations with whom we work. So we don't just teach in classrooms and laboratories and architecture studios on our campuses, but you will find Causes team members like Yao and Mary teaching in schools, religious and community centers, community gardens and farmers markets in every ward of the District of Columbia. If you would like more information, please visit us at www.udc.edu/causes. I am Sabine O'Hara. Thank you for watching. See you next time on Causes.